Brent, thanks so much for being here with me today.
Thanks a lot for having me.
Tell me a little bit about what you do.
So I'm the CEO and co-founder of a company called Cognoa, and we have a mobile app that we put in the hands of parents and pediatricians, and it allows parents to answer some simple questions and then provide samples of their child's natural play behavior at home. And from that, we can use machine learning algorithms that was developed by a professor here at Stanford who was previously out at Harvard Medical School, and we can use that to help parents understand the social, cognitive, and language development of their child, what their child doing well, and then what their child might need to work on, and we can help the parent understand how to best assist and help the development of their child.
It's really exciting. What drew you to that kind of a work?
Well, I think really was the idea when I first met Dr. Wall and I saw his science, to be able to start engaging and empowering parents. You know, a lot of people, especially at this conference and at other conferences, are looking, how do you move clinical grade science closer and clinical grade decision making closer to everyday patients? And one of the areas, since this is Childx, one of the areas that everyone's focused on here is, how do you engage for better child development? And if you look at the numbers, one of the things that's just so compelling is that for the serious development delays like autism, the average age, the CDC tells us that parents see the signs and symptoms is 19 months. And yet the average age of diagnosis is 4.5.
So such a gap.
It's a huge gap. And parents spend 3 years not knowing what to do. And what we've seen with other patient empowerment and patient engagement platforms with adults is that the first step is education. If you can educate patients, you can start to engage them, and if you engage them, you usually get to better outcomes. It works in weight loss, it works in so many things. And so our focus was, who better to educate and engage than the parents, because the parents are with these children 24/7, and who's more invested in getting a better outcome than the parent?
I think a lot of people look at innovation and they think, we have these research scientists with these amazing ideas, and then we have the patient, and never the two shall meet. Mm-hmm. How can we bridge this gap?
Yeah, I think that's a great question. People sometimes have a tendency to see the problems being solved in the laboratory, and then they see the problems out in the wild, and it's hard to see the bridging function between the two of them. And I think that it happens on both sides. In our example, when Dr. Wall, who's a machine learning and data scientist, was trying to look at what are the data points that you could use to help parents understand earlier just where they are. Do they need to worry? Because let's face it, I'm a parent. All parents worry.
Every parent worries, yeah.
That's part of being a good parent, actually. Genetically, there's a reason why we worry, right?
Sure, because, yeah, of course, yeah.
But you want to know if you're worrying about the right things, and it's nice to check the things off the list. And so he had this innovative idea to look at the data sets and do the classic machine learning like you would do in genomics to say, listen, is there a subset of data that would predict the outcome? But then, he did that, and he showed that with a smaller set of data, he could predict with a very high degree of accuracy whether or not children were likely to be on the autism spectrum, for example. Right. So we could try to get them to the front of the line. But then he did what I would say is kind of a bridging study. When he looked at all the data points, some of them parents could just tell you, but some things you had to see the kid. And the whole problem is there's a one-year bottleneck. When a pediatrician refers a child, the average wait to get your child seen is 13 months in the U.S. And so, same bottleneck, right? Someone still has to see the child. And he had an aha moment, right? His aha moment was he set up a clinical study and he asked parents associated with Harvard to upload videos of their kids at a birthday party, playing with kids. And it was just
onto YouTube?
Yeah. Well, actually, they set up a private channel, but just upload it. But basically, YouTube videos, right? And a lot of the stuff that he got in was uninterpretable, right?
Sure.
But he was able to look at enough of them, and he was able to see, hey, the little behavior elements that I needed, I got out of this. And that's where the light went off to say, listen, we could be disruptive in the hands of parents, because there's certain things we could ask them, and some things we just need to see. But guess what? It doesn't have to be the office visit.
Right. You kind of turn the tables.
Yeah. So I think that trying to solve the problem first and not worrying about the systemic constraints, he never would have done step two.
Start with the innovation and then kind of work on the feasibility. One last question for you. All these exciting innovations you've heard about today, is there anything that you're going to take back and really think on or really might influence your work?
One of the areas that's on the forefront of a lot of people's minds right now is the idea of the vaccine versus autism debate. And of course, we're in the developmental delay space. One in six kids in the United States has development delay, one in 68 has autism. And so it's something that everybody's aware of. And the for people on the science side that understand the numbers, it's very frustrating that there are people that aren't vaccinating because maybe they just don't quite understand the numbers behind it. And it was interesting the way that Dana from IDEO thought about it. She said, really what you need to do is you need to tell stories. And you need to tell stories. It's not about trying to drill in science. You don't attack a belief argument with data. You address a belief argument with stories because those are the belief systems. And she talked about telling stories to try to bring these things together. And I think a lot of us, when we have technology-based product, even like we do at Cognoa, we have a tendency to want to show people the numbers for why this is a great idea. And yet what almost always resonates when we talk to parents is that parents reach out to us and it was a story of someone else using the product or someone else who could have benefited from this type of information, that ends up being the thing that really drives adoption. And so I think it's good for us always to step back and just kind of think about what are the stories behind this that makes it all seem more tangible and personal.
That's what people connect with.
Definitely.
That's great. Brent, thank you so much for coming to Childx, and thanks for speaking with me today.
Great, thank you.
Take care.